I want to welcome everybody that's joining us here in person today, as well as those that are joining us online. Can we give it up for our online audience? Yeah, if you are joining us online, I'd love for you, just below this video, you'll see a button that says subscribe. I'd love for you to click the subscribe so that you can continue to get fresh content from our church each and every week. Today is a special day, because tomorrow we celebrate the life of a great man. Can we give it up for the Dr. Martin Luther King Jr.? Come on. Yeah. He's a legend to some, the embodiment of an idea to others, but to your pastor, he is a hero. Yeah, he's my hero. I have spent the large majority of my career studying his life, and I would argue that I'm going to spend the rest of my career studying his life, because his life was so rich. He left an incredible legacy, which, by the way, let me just say this. You do know that your life should be worth more than just going to work and coming home and get back up and do it the next day. You do know that you need to leave a legacy for those that are behind you. Come on, somebody. We're not just trying to do life. We're trying to change this place. We want to leave a legacy for our kids and our kids' kids. Come on, somebody. When we die, people ought to notice. When we die, people should notice. Dr. King left such a mark on our country, on our world, really, that when he died, people noticed. Now, here's the thing. We cannot talk about Dr. King's legacy without also talking about what he lived and died for. Now, there are certain people who would like to whitewash history and make it as though the only thing he lived and died for was nonviolence. Now, you have to understand, nonviolence was very important in what he did, but you know history. You know that nonviolence was simply the strategy that he used to get to a place. What is that place? A place of justice and equality. Now, that's uncomfortable to talk about in our society, so we whitewash it and we say, well, no, he didn't come for nonviolence. He came for justice and equality. The way he got to that place was nonviolence. Amen? Everybody with me? And so what we're going to do today is we're going to talk about justice and equality. As we jump in, I've got to lay a foundation, and here's the foundation that I want you to understand. Justice and equality are not human concepts. They are biblical imperatives. When you look at societies going back to the beginning of time, people do not track in the direction of doing right, typically. People do not track in the direction of equality. People have a tendency to track in the direction of injustice. But then God comes in through his word and says, I demand more of you, especially those of you who are followers of Jesus Christ. It is not a human concept. It is a biblical imperative. So if we call ourselves Christians, justice and equality are something that we have to be good at. Amen? And so that's what we're going to deal with today. Jesus is all about justice. He's all about making those things that are wrong right. He's all about equality. Why? Because he created us all the same. Come on, somebody. Black, white, Hispanic, it doesn't matter what you are. God created us all equally. And the Bible goes on to say in Acts chapter 10, verse 34, then Peter opened his mouth and he said, in truth, I perceive that God shows no partiality. There are some translations that say that he is not a respecter of persons. There are other translations that go on to say that God shows no preference. Well, if you think about it, that makes perfect sense. Because if he's our father and we're all his children, good parents do not show preference for one child over the other. Good parents do not show partiality towards one child over another. Good parents do not respect one child and then disrespect the others. God created us all equally. It doesn't matter what your skin color is. It doesn't matter what your background is. God created us all equally. Amen? Now, you might say to yourself, well, Pastor, isn't this kind of all obvious? Like, isn't it apparent that God created us all equally? Here's what I need you to understand. For centuries, we have been told a lie. We have even been told the lie by pastors standing in pulpits. The lie that we've been told is that somehow God has preference for certain groups over other groups. That God has an order that he's created, and that order was created based upon skin complexion. I need you to know that is a lie straight from the pit of hell. There is nothing in Scripture that says that one group was created unequal to the other. In fact, everything in Scripture talks about equality amongst humanity. But the reality is, this lie has gotten a lot of legs. This lie has made its way around, because if you tell a lie for long enough, people will begin to believe it. Future generations will continue to perpetuate it as though it's the truth, when in all honesty, it's a lie. This lie is the reason why police brutality exists more in certain communities than it does in other communities. This lie is the reason why we see all of the inequities in or the racial disparities in education, in healthcare, in the workplace. This lie is the reason why Black Lives Matter exists. Is it a Christian organization that always gets it right? Absolutely not. However, they exist to try to fix a problem that only exists because of a lie that has been perpetuated since 1619. Come on, somebody. And so don't get mad at the people trying to fix the problem. Fix the problem. So today, we're going to deal with the residue of a lie that has existed in this country for hundreds of years. If you tell a lie, like I said, long enough, people will begin to believe it. And that's what I feel like we deal with in our country to this day. This is why the same things keep happening over and over and over again. And we're like, why are we dealing with this again? Because we never actually fixed the problem. If you don't fix the root of the problem, then the problem never goes away. Now, there are some people who would like to turn a blind eye and pretend like this doesn't exist, because if you could pretend like it exists, maybe it'll all just go away. No, that's not how things work. Your parents taught you that. If you pretend like your room is dirty, if you pretend like your room is clean, will that make it clean? No, it only becomes clean when you address the problem and fix the problem. And so do not pretend as though somehow all of this got cleaned up. There's no longer an issue in America. Yes, there is. Don't ever let anybody tell you that there's something wrong with your culture. In fact, the folks that are the most ignorant say negative things about your culture because they don't know nothing about your culture. Whether you're white, black, Hispanic, they don't know nothing about you. So don't let anybody tell you that there's something lesser about you. No, you are beautiful. Whether you're white, black, Hispanic, you are beautiful just the way you are. God created you the way he created you for a reason. Amen? God didn't make no mistakes. He did not make any mistakes. All right, now y'all ready for the message? Anytime you pick up a bottle of medication, there is always the fine print. Now, we never read the fine print, but the fine print is important. So let me give you some fine print for today's message. Number one is this. Our time today is not designed to deal with every social issue in America. So if you look at what I'm talking about today and you say, well, he didn't address this injustice or that injustice. He didn't address homelessness. He didn't address sexual trafficking. He didn't address any of that stuff. I want you to know that's on purpose. I want you to know that all of that is important to us because we believe it's important to our God. And so we will address them over time, but we're not going to address them today. Everybody with me? The second thing that we need to know as we go in is that the last conversation that we had about this as a church was back in 2020. Now, we were not yet a church that met every weekend on Sundays at that point. We were just a launch team, and George Floyd happened, and here we are. We're doing Zoom and that kind of stuff, and we decided that we needed to speak into issues of injustice and inequality. But how many of you all know it should not take an event like a George Floyd to have a conversation about race, injustice, and inequality in America? It's something that should be dealt with on a consistent basis. And so as a church, we're not going to just talk about this when something bad happens. We're going to create an ongoing conversation that's going to continue on and on and on. Does that make sense? Now, I truly believe that the church has to lead this conversation, because the world is looking to us to take lead. The moment we take the back seat, the world has no clue what to do. In fact, the world has done a pretty good job of messing this thing up. And so it's God's church that's going to be the one to fix it, but it's going to require us being bold. It's going to require us having conversations and not being afraid. In fact, I would argue that Satan has done a really good job of keeping us quiet as the church about this, because as long as we are quiet, as long as we get uncomfortable, then we won't deal with the things that need to be fixed. Thus, they continue on. So as a church, we're going to continue. We're going to talk about this on a regular basis, not every weekend. Now, some of y'all are like little activists. We're not going to talk about this every weekend, okay? But we are going to deal with this. Amen. This message, and in any time we talk about this, we are not targeting a particular group, because there is no individual or no group of people in here that I know of that have perpetuated this moral or social injustice that we see in our country. So if you walk out of here feeling in any kind of way shameful or guilty or disgusting, I need you to have a conversation with me. But more importantly, I need you to have a conversation with God. And I need you to ask him, why is it when conversations about race are brought up, why do I get to the place where I feel so uncomfortable that I don't want to talk about it, right? It's something that has to be talked about, especially as Christians, right? So we're not going to run away from it, nor are we going to feel shameful or guilty. Last thing I'm going to say, and I'm going to jump in. This is not a political conversation. This is not a political conversation. What the enemy has done a great job of doing is if you hear something that you heard a politician with either an R or a D behind their name say, then you automatically put me in that group with that politician. Then if you agree with that political party, you will tune in. If you disagree with that political party, you will tune out, okay? That is garbage. That is straight from the enemy. And that's one of the things that stop us from getting anywhere. This is not a political conversation. This is a Jesus conversation. Amen? All right. Y'all ready to jump in? Let's pray. Lord, that was my introduction. Lord, I believe you got something great that you want us to hear today. I believe that there's some things that you're wanting to tear down in our lives, some things that are holding us back from living out your word, God. There's some things that we need to hear to get us on fire to create the change that we all know we so desperately need in our nation. And so, God, I pray that we would hear exactly what it is we need to hear today. God, speak through me. It's in Jesus' name we pray. And everybody said, amen. Amen. If you will, do me a favor, open your Bibles to John chapter 4. And we're going to start at verse number 3. John chapter 4. And we're going to start at verse number 3. So today what we're going to do is we're going to get a little bit of Jesus. We're going to get a little bit of Dr. King. And we're also going to get a little bit of history. So you're going to walk out of here with a lot. I hope you brought your notes. This is going to be, you need to refer back to this stuff. This is some good stuff. All right. This is referring to Jesus. Everything I'm reading is referring to Jesus. So verse number 3 says, so he left Judea and went back once more to Galilee. Now he had to go through Samaria. Now all of that might mean nothing to you until I give you a little bit of context. So you have in the Jewish world, there were two primary locations that Jewish people lived. They lived in Judea and they lived in Galilee. Judea was in the south. Galilee was in the north. Most of Jesus' ministry was done in Galilee. However, he was born in Judea. Everybody with me? Okay? Whenever, and now, in the middle, there was a place called Samaria. That's where we get the word Samaritan from. Jewish people did not get along with Samaritan people. So because of that, they always traveled around Samaria whenever they were going either to or from Judea or Galilee. Everybody with me on that? However, the text says that Jesus had to go through Samaria. Why would Jesus have to go through Samaria if for generations Jewish people had made a path around Samaria when they were going either to Judea or to Galilee? Here's why. He didn't have to go through Samaria because there was a lack of alternative routes. He had to go through Samaria because there was a meeting that was about to happen. There was an ordained meeting that was about to happen with a woman at a well. Everybody with me? All right, let's go to verse number 5. So he came to a town in Samaria called Sychar, near the plot of ground Jacob had given his son Joseph. Jacob's well was there, and Jesus, tired as he was from the journey, sat down by the well. It was about noon. Verse 7, when a Samaritan woman came to draw water, Jesus said to her, "Will you give me a drink?" The Samaritan woman said to him, "You are a Jew, and I am a Samaritan woman. How can you ask me for a drink? For Jews do not associate with Samaritans." So this woman found it incredibly strange that Jesus, a Jewish man, would be willing to have a conversation with her, a Samaritan woman. Let me give you a little bit more context of why she found that strange. Like I said, Samaritans and Jewish people did not get along. Jewish people saw Samaritans as lower than dogs. This is actually in historical writings. The reason why is because Samaritans had over the years begun to have relations with people from other ethnic groups and ethnic backgrounds. So you all are smart, okay? Let's go back to school for just a minute. If for generation after generation after generation, the Samaritan people who initially were Jews began to have relations with ethnic groups that were not Jewish, could we reasonably infer that over time, a Samaritan person would have looked a little different from a Jewish person? Can we reasonably infer that their skin color might have looked a little different? Can we reasonably infer that their hair texture, their eye color, their culture might have been a little different? Would they have danced a little bit differently during the songs that we played a couple of minutes ago? Yeah. Yet and still, these are the people that Jesus said, "I want to draw closer to." These are the people that Jesus said, "I need to go through Samaria to get to." Remember, he didn't go through Samaria because there was no other route. He went through Samaria because he needed to have an interaction with this woman. If you continue reading, you'll see that the interaction didn't just end with this woman. This woman would go on to tell everybody in the village that she just met a man named Jesus. Then the people asked Jesus, "Would you stay with us?" He said, "Absolutely." He stayed for another 2 days there. Not only did he stay there for 2 days, but he began to build relationships with the people there. The question you have to ask yourself is, why would Jesus do that? Write this down. I believe that Jesus did this because he wanted to model for us what it looks like to build bridges and tear down walls. Jesus is all about building bridges and tearing down walls. Christians do not put up walls. We tear them down. We build bridges to the people that are different. We don't say, "Well, you're different, so thus you stay over there and I'm going to stay over here." People in the world do that. But as Christians, we don't do that. We build bridges with people that are different from us. In fact, Jesus didn't just wait for it to happen. Jesus went and sought it out, which means that if we're going to be followers of his, we need to seek out people that are different from us so that we can try to build the bridge with them. Does that make sense? Everybody with me? I feel like, first of all, as humans, we love walls. I feel like for the past 5 years, we've talked about walls over and over and over and over again in our society. In fact, even before that, I remember my HOA, we live in a gated community. There's a gate at the front, but the developer never built a wall around the community. Now, mind you, my HOA has no crime. Like, if you look at the little crime blotter thing, there is no crime ever in my community. However, at the HOA meetings, people kept saying, "We need a wall. We need a wall. We need a wall. We need a wall." I raised my hand one time. I'll never forget. I raised my hand one time and I said, "Guys, there's no crime in our community. What do we need to build a $1 million wall for?" I swear to God, they all just ignored me and kept on talking about the fact that we need a wall. We need a wall. They ended up building a $1 million wall. Now, we got all kinds of things that we need in our community, but they felt like there was an invisible threat and they needed to make sure they kept out that threat. We love walls, but as Christians, we're called to build bridges, not walls. Write this down. Be careful when walls bring you more comfort than bridges. Be careful when you're more comfortable keeping out the other than you are welcoming and bringing in the other. Be careful when you're all about keeping separation between you and somebody else that's different. Now, what is justice? At its core, justice, fairness, equality, and equity are all bridge building. We're talking about justice and equality today. Those are all bridge building. Like I said, as Christians, we need to be really good at building bridges. So I'm going to give you a couple of things today that are going to help make us incredible bridge builders. Everybody with me? Let's build some bridges. Number one, write this down. We're going to make a decision to draw closer to the person that's different. We're going to make the intentional decision to draw closer to people that are different from us. You have a role in this society to build bridges with people that are different from you. We cannot stand back and watch other people build the bridges. No, we have to make the intentional decision to build the bridges. And you might say to yourself, well, Pastor, I didn't create the problem. No, neither did Jesus. Jesus didn't create the problem between Jews and Samaritans, but he still chose to step in and fix the problem. Write this down. You didn't create the problem, but you're responsible for fixing it, helping to fix it. Yeah, you didn't create the problem here in America, but you are responsible for helping to fix it. It would be like you showing up on a new job. You just got a new job. You find out that they had all kind of financial issues in place because they had a financial downfall in the past. They give you a credit card, and you say, well, I didn't create the problems, the financial issues they had in the past, so I'm just going to spend. No, even though you don't create the problem, you're still responsible for helping to fix it. There's a gentleman named Miles McPherson. Miles McPherson leads a church in San Diego called The Rock Church. He named it after me. A very, very diverse church. And he was writing this book, incredible book called The Third Option. One of the best books I've ever read on race in America. Please go pick it up. The Third Option. And what he did was he wanted to do some research in advance in order to make sure that this was a great book. So he had four of his staff members, all of them happened to have been white. He asked them to go and spend a day in a community of color. Well, one of them right off bat says, I will not go and spend a day in a community of color. He asked him, well, why won't you do that? He said, I'm not going to put myself in a position where I get shot. You see, what happens is if you have spent your whole life building walls, what ends up happening is you have ignorance about what's on the other side of the wall. And so that puts you in a place where you are uncomfortable. The other three made a decision to lean into the uncomfortability. They went and had an incredible experience that they reported about, and you can read in the book what their experience was like. But this one individual, because he made a decision to keep the wall up, he missed out on what God was trying to do in his life. God has something for us, but in order to get to that place, we got to be willing to tear down the walls with people that are around us. Everybody with me? Now, you might be listening to this, and if you're black or Hispanic, you might say, well, I am disqualified from this conversation because I got white people everywhere. There are white people in my community. There are white people at my job. I got white people everywhere. But write this part down. Just because you spend time around people that are different doesn't mean you're building bridges. See, just rubbing shoulders with people that are different from you doesn't mean you're a bridge builder. Jesus, you'll read in John chapter 4, intentionally built relationships with and got to know the people that were in Samaria. Had he have just brushed shoulders with them, I would not have been able to make the argument that I make about the need for us to build bridges. Jesus did not just brush shoulders with them. He was intentional about building bridges with them. You need to, it's more than just rubbing shoulders with people that are different from you. You got to go out of your way to build relationships with them. Amen? All right. Now, everything that I'm sharing is for people who follow Jesus. Now, if you don't follow Jesus, this ain't for you. If you just like the word, the title Christian, then you don't even need to follow this. But if you actually call yourself a follower of Jesus, meaning I'm willing to do what Jesus did, this is what Jesus did. Jesus built bridges with the people that were different from him. Jesus didn't stay away from different people. Jesus leaned into people that were different. Amen? All right, next thing we got to do is we got to pray. We got to pray. We have got to get to a place where we are willing to get down on our knees and pray for the change that we know we need to see in our society. We can't do it on our own. We need the help of God. We got to believe that God can change more in the snap of his fingers than we could do with years and years and years of effort. We got to pray. 1965, February, it's the, February 1965, it's the height of the civil rights movement. Congressman John Lewis goes to Selma, Alabama. The plan is for him and 600 protesters to march from Selma, Alabama to Montgomery, Alabama to protest voting injustices that were happening all across the nation. They line up. They go across the Selma Bridge, which was called the Edmund Pettus Bridge. And when they get to the other side of the bridge, there are about 150 state troopers there. And then this happens. Check this out. This was known as Bloody Sunday, because these protesters were beat with nightsticks. There were police dogs turned on them. But here's the thing I love most about them. They didn't give up. 2 weeks later, they show back up at the same place. This time, Dr. King is there. And Dr. King assembles all 600 protesters. They walk across the Edmund Pettus Bridge. Same 150 state troopers there. Dr. King stands there and he tells everyone to sit down. He has everybody sit down and then he begins to pray over all of them. In fact, we got a picture here of that moment. He prays over everybody. When he's done praying, he tells everybody to stand up and to turn around. He says, we're going back across the bridge. Now you got to imagine, they found that a little crazy, okay? We done came all the way out here. Our plan is to march to Montgomery, and now you're talking about we're going to go home? He has everybody stand up, go back across the bridge. Everybody went home. 2 weeks later, they come back to the same bridge. They get across the bridge, same 150 state troopers, but this time something had changed. You see, there was a judge that made it illegal for the state troopers to stand in the way of the protesters. So the 150 state troopers had to part, kind of like they parted the Red Sea. And they were able to march from Selma to Montgomery. 5 months later, the Civil Rights Voting Act was signed into law. Here's the thing I need you to catch. Without, by the way, when they turned around, that was called Turnaround Tuesday. Without a Turnaround Tuesday, there wouldn't have been a Civil Rights Voting Act. If they would not have gotten on their knees and prayed, nothing would have gone the way they expected for it to go. It was the prayer that changed things. So if you look at the George Floyd situation and it frustrates you, it frustrates me as well. We need to pray. If you look at the pay gap that exists between whites and folks of color, I don't like it either. We need to pray. If you look at the high incarceration rates of black and Latino men, I don't like it either. We need to pray. Do not act on injustices without first praying. We got to seek God if we want to see real change happen. Amen? Here's the last thing we're going to do. We're not going to fear pushback. We're not going to fear pushback. Anytime you do something big for God, there are always going to be people that are going to push back. It kind of comes along with the territory. That's just how it goes. So many people, when there's pushback, they're like, I didn't expect all of this pushback. What should I do? You should expect it. Anytime you're trying to create change in the society, there are going to be people that are going to push back. That's just how it goes. We're not going to fear pushback. In fact, I want you to write this down. Standing for justice and equality have never been the cool thing to do, but they've always been the godly thing to do. Yeah, they've never been the cool thing to do. If you're looking for cool, don't stand for justice and equality. The cool thing to do is just go along with what everything that's happening. They've always been the godly thing to do, though. Standing up for injustice, standing for what's right, it's always been the godly thing to do. It's never been the cool thing to do. Never, ever, ever let naysayers stop you from doing the thing that God has placed in your heart. In fact, let me just say this. If you have a heart for injustice, if you have a heart for inequality, if you feel burdened by that, I want you to know you didn't give yourself that heart. God gave you that heart. God gave that to you because not everybody feels that way. God gave you that heart. Never let naysayers stop you from doing the thing that God has placed on the inside of your heart. I got a quick story that I'm going to share, and it might sound like I'm veering off. I'm not. I'm going to tie it all up. I need you guys to roll with me. I've got my wife and I, we have a couple that we're friends with. We've been friends with them for like 12, 13 years now. And about 8 years ago, the husband came to the wife and he says, "Hey, honey, you know, when you come to bed and you put on this thing on your head, you know, like how women, y'all put that contraption on your head. I don't even know what that is. You put this thing on your head." He said, "Baby, it's just hard for me to get excited." By the way, we got a sermon series called Real Love About Marriage coming up in a couple of weeks, okay? One of my first sermons is about you got to go to bed looking like a woman, ladies. I'm just saying, okay? You got to go to bed. Look, I'm joking. I'm joking. That's not what it's about. That's not what it's about. So, y'all wrap that thing on your head, babe. I told you to bring one of them things for me. Some of y'all might not even know what I'm talking about. Yeah, I got to show you what this thing looks like because it is incredible, ladies. You wake up in the morning, you're a fine woman. You go to bed at night, you look like Tyrone. We don't want to go to bed with Tyrone. I'm just saying. We don't want to go. You put this thing on your head. What is this? What is this thing? What is this? Okay? We don't want to see this, ladies. We don't want to see this, okay? So this friend of ours, she creates, trying to please her husband, she creates this cap that she called attaching wrap. And the way it worked was she put some weave into a cap, and you could easily put this cap on your head, and it was comfortable because the alternative was a wig, and wigs are uncomfortable, I understand. And so she created this thing, and it started selling like hotcakes from the beginning. Now, she thought that her customer base was going to be other women trying to please their husbands. Come to find out, it was actually cancer patients. Because what would happen is when a woman who has cancer takes chemo, her hair begins to fall out, and all of them were going towards wigs before, but then they realized this is a really comfortable cap. So they begin buying the cap. So our friend runs into a little problem. And the problem has nothing to do with money. The problem has nothing to do with vision. She has both of those. The problem that she ran into was that she could never get her friends and family to see the vision that God had given her. Which, by the way, let me go back. Remember last week I told you, sometimes your friends and family aren't crazy. It's just that God didn't give them the vision that he gave you. He gave it to you. So they can't see what God gave to you because he gave it to you and not to them. So because she could not get her family members excited, because she couldn't even get her husband excited about it, she quit. She dropped the business. Not only did she quit on the business, but she quit on all of the cancer patients that were purchasing her attaching wrap. Here's what I need you to write down. If you're going to be successful, and this is not just talking about social justice, it's talking about in anything you do in life. If you're going to be successful, you need to stop looking for cheerleaders. If you're going to be successful, you need to stop looking for cheerleaders. If you look at the advent of Expansion Church, when I left my former church, I was looking for all kinds of cheerleaders. I was like, this is going to be great. We're going to have a whole cheering squad. Woo! Go! And then we get out there, and I realize I don't have a single cheerleader. What in the world is going on? If I would have stopped and not done the thing that God called me to do, this church would not exist today. You cannot get in a place where you're constantly looking for cheerleaders. When you step out and do the thing God called you to do, you're not going to have fans. You're not going to have fans because they can't see what you can see. Now, here's the thing. They will see one day. But in the beginning, they can't see what you can see because God gave it to you. Everybody with me? Going back to Dr. King. Dr. King did not have cheerleaders. In fact, the United States government was against him. This is actually in the record books. In fact, I think the FBI is supposed to be releasing all of what they did within the next year or two, something like that. Not only that, he's got a large portion of the population in America that are angry with him, don't want him to move forward. And then, even within the black community, there were people that began to become frustrated because they felt like things were not happening as quickly doing the nonviolent strategy as they thought they should have been. Which, let me give you a quick history note. The reason why the Black Panther Party even came about was because people were frustrated at the fact that the nonviolent strategy was not working as quickly as they wanted it to work. So they figured, let's just go the violent route. Come on, somebody. If you're going to be successful and you're going to do the thing God called you to do, whatever that is, everybody knows what that thing is in your heart because God placed it there. Don't look for cheerleaders. You're going to have naysayers. Get ready for the naysayers. It just comes with the territory. Everybody with me? There's a quote from Dr. King. This is in his last message. It's the day before he was assassinated. This is what he says. He says, like anybody, I would like to live a long life. Longevity has its place, but I'm not concerned about that now. I just want to do God's will. In other words, yeah, I could go on and live another 30, 40, 50 years. Yeah, I can raise my kids to adulthood. Yeah, I can do all that, but I'm not concerned with any of that. I just want to do God's will. I think what we need is more believers willing to say, I don't care what people think about me. I don't care about what Fox News and CNN has to say. I don't care about what social media has to say. I don't care what even people of my own skin color have to say. I want to do God's will. I'm going to do what's right. It doesn't matter what anybody thinks about me. I want to do what's right. Why? Because we live for an audience of one as Christians. His name is Jesus. We live for him. We're not living for the approval of other people. If you've been living your life looking for the approval of other people, oh, you're not going to really get anywhere. Stop looking for the approval of other people. We live for an audience of one. We live to bring a smile to his face. Dr. King didn't live a long life like you and I are going to live. However, he died one of the happiest men you would ever meet. Why? Because he did God's will. And so what is that for you? I don't know what that is for you. Maybe it's when it comes to justice and equality. Maybe God has laid something on your heart about making this world a better place. Maybe it's a business idea. Maybe it's a nonprofit that God has given you. I don't know what that is for you, but whatever it is, you just need to get in your heart, I'm going to do God's will no matter what. I don't care what other people think. I don't care what it seems like. I don't care what the world is doing. I'm going to do what I know to be right because I live for an audience of one. Amen? And so every time I... Come on, Artavius. Every time I write a message, not only am I thinking about what do I want you to know, but I'm thinking about what do I want you to do. But this message, I can't really tell you what you need to do. I really think that is something that you need to spend some time with God on. I don't know. Maybe God is calling you to be the next Dr. King. I don't know. Maybe there's some other social injustice thing that really gets you on fire. By the way, let me just say this. Whatever the thing is that keeps you up at night, that gets you angry, is probably the thing God wants you to fix. If every time you see it, it bothers you and people around you aren't bothered, it's not that they're bad. It's just that God gave them something different from what he gave you. So I don't know what your next step is, but I know you have a next step. Everybody has a next step. Everybody can do something in this area of their lives. Some of us, when it comes to the person that's different from us, you become an expert at building walls. In fact, I would argue in some cases, you feel like it's a holy thing to build walls. In fact, there was something I was going to share, and I kind of moved through it really quickly, and I just feel the need to say it. I was meeting with a group of ladies down in Martin County. This is the Martin County chapter of MOPS, Mothers of Preschoolers. And they asked me if I would come in and speak to them about race in America. So I came in, we had a great conversation, we did a Q&A at the end. And in the Q&A, one woman asked several questions, and then her last question was, my child is in a school, in a particular class where there are several kids that are gay. And she leaves it like that and says, what should I do? And I'm like, what do you mean, what should you do? What would Jesus do in a situation like that? Would Jesus withdraw his child from the class? Would Jesus withdraw his child from the school? Or would Jesus teach his child how to love someone that is different from him? Now, I recognize that some of y'all get mad because a pastor said we should love those that are homosexual. Here's what I need you to understand. If you get angry because the church tells you that you should love those who are different from you, there is something wrong with your Christianity. Now, the reality is, do we agree with that lifestyle? No. Do we believe it's God's best for humanity? No. Do we believe that marriage is between one man and one woman? Absolutely. But we're never going to push away the person that's different. Why? Because a lot of us come in here with stuff and you don't want the church to push you away. You got mess in your life and you want the church to embrace you with your mess, then we need to embrace. Thank you. We need to embrace other people who got issues in their life. And so I don't know what God is telling you need to do as a result of this message. However, I know that you have a next step, and I'm going to pray. I'm going to pray now that God would make it crystal clear to you what your next step is. And so with all heads bowed and all eyes closed, let's pray. Jesus, we thank you for your word. We thank you, God, that you were a model for us of what it looks like to draw closer to the person that is different from us. God, we thank you that, God, you weren't just some distant God way out there. God, we thank you that you would send your son, Jesus, model for us, to show us, to demonstrate what it looks like to love everybody. So, Lord, I pray that you would speak to each and every one of our hearts today. Give us the next step. God, help us to know what you want us to do with this. God, help us to take and put the naysayers on the back burner and put your will on the front burner. God, help us to pray. God, we need to fall on our knees and be willing to seek you, God, knowing, God, that, God, you could do far more with the snap of your fingers than we could ever do, God, in years and years of work. God, I don't know what everyone in here's next step is, God, but I know they have a next step. So, Lord, I pray that you would impress it upon their hearts what it is you want them to do with this. It's in your holy and matchless name we pray. And everybody said, amen.